Good morning. Welcome to Marsh Creek Community Church. My name's Tara, and I want to thank you for joining us today. I wanted to let you know about some things that are happening in the month of October in the life of our church. For almost the past year now, we have had the privilege of having Pastor John Wright serve as interim pastor. It's been wonderful from a staff perspective to have someone here leading us, encouraging us, helping us prepare for when we have a new lead pastor. He's also been a wonderful support to our leadership team, also helping them prepare for our new lead pastor, which we were excited to announce, Ryan Stockton and his family. We confirmed that back in August, and we're looking forward to welcoming Pastor Ryan and his family in the month of October. So October 10th, which is next Sunday, will be Pastor John's final week with us. And we're having a celebration and thank you time for him after the service. We would love for you to join us after the service, which is at 10 o'clock. If you can't make it or you would like to send him a thank you or just send him a note of encouragement, you can send him an email. His email is johnguywrites@gmail.com. You can also send him a card to our mailing address, which is 256 Eagle View Boulevard, Suite 399, Exton, Pennsylvania, 19341. We will make sure he gets that. And then on October 17th, we are looking forward to having Bishop Brian Hoke, who oversees our church congregation of the Brethren in Christ, along with a lot of other churches in our area. He will be at church with the Stockton family to install Pastor Ryan as the new lead pastor of Marsh Creek Community Church. We're so looking forward to that time with Ryan and his family, and we're going to also have a celebration after the service. We also have some women's Bible studies that are going to be starting. One is starting this week on Wednesdays, and then we have another one that we're hoping to start later in the month. So for all of these events, please go to our website, our events page, which is www.marshcreekchurch.org/events, and you'll find details for all of these events that I just talked about. So thanks again for being with us today. We hope you enjoy your time with us. We enjoyed having you. Have a great day and a great week.
I worship you. You are. I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working.
You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop. You never stop working. You never stop. You never stop. You're good.
You're good.
Oh.
Earlier this year, on March 21st, Dick Hoyt died at the age of 80 from congestive heart failure. Dick was no ordinary man, and his life is a testimony of a dad encouraging and supporting his son. You see, his son, Rick Hoyt, was born with a severe form of cerebral palsy. He was unable to move his arms or his legs. He could not speak, but he could communicate with the aid of a computer. When Rick was in high school, he asked his father to participate in a 5-mile run, which was being held to benefit a classmate who had been paralyzed in an accident. His dad, wanting to encourage and support his son, ran the race while pushing his son the whole way. After that race, his son, talking through the help of a computer, said this to his father: "When we were running, it felt as though my disability disappeared." Over the next 40 years, Dick Hoyt and his son would compete in more than 1,000 races around the world, including 72 marathons and 257 triathlons, 6 of which were Ironman competitions. This story has stuck with me from the first time I heard it. It illustrates so well what it means to encourage and support another person. Some of the pictures from a triathlon illustrates what it means to go the extra mile for another person. You see, in a triathlon, you have to swim 1.2 miles. In the Ironman, you have to swim 2.4 miles. And he did this pulling his son while swimming. And you have to bike 56 miles in a triathlon. In the Ironman, you have to bike 112 miles. And he did this with his son attached to the bike. And then you have to run 13.1 miles in a triathlon and 26.2 miles in an Ironman. And he did that while pushing his son. When I think of such an incredible story, it makes me also think of another father-son combination. The work of the Father's Spirit joining with our spirit to encourage us and to support us. The Greek word parakletos describes that role. Parakletos is a calling to one's aid. It comes from two words put together: para, by the side of, and kaleo, to call alongside. You see, God is the one who is running this race with us. And we are not alone. Here's some of what that word means as you break it down. It suggests the capability or adaptability of giving aid. It was used in a court of justice to denote a legal assistant, counsel for the defense, or an advocate. Generally, one who pleads another's case, an intercessor. In the widest sense, it signifies comforter or encourager. In John 14, Jesus speaks specifically about the comforter, the encourager who will be given. This is what he says: "I will ask the Father, and he will give you another counselor or encourager to be with you forever, the Spirit of truth. The world cannot accept him because it neither sees him nor knows him. But you know him, for he lives with you and will be in you. I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you. And not only will we have an encourager in our lives, but we also are to be an encourager to other people. And so we read in Scripture, Jesus died for us so that whether we are awake or asleep, we may live together with him. Therefore, encourage one another and build each other up, just as in fact you are doing. Or in Hebrews, where it says, encourage one another daily, as long as it is called today, so that none of you may be hardened by sin's deceitfulness. So how can we leave a legacy of encouragement? And how can we do that, especially as we are on mission with Jesus in our world? I'd like to take a look at another man who was a great encourager. In fact, he got the nickname of Great Encourager. His life story actually gives some principles for encouraging other people. And I'd like to take a look at his life with you. You'll find his story in the book of Acts. Take a closer look with me. You and I can be an encouragement by offering our resources to others. In Acts, we read this about this great encourager. All the believers were one in heart and mind. No one claimed that any of his possession was his own, but they shared everything they had. With great power, the apostles continued to testify to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and much grace was upon them all. There were no needy persons among them, for from time to time, those who owned land or houses sold them, brought the money from the sales, and put it at the apostles' feet. And it was distributed to anyone as he had need. Joseph, a Levite from Cyprus, whom the apostles called Barnabas, which means son of encouragement, sold the field he owned and brought the money and put it at the apostles' feet. The transition that is found in the book of Acts between the ending of chapter 4 and the beginning of chapter 5 is highly instructive. You see, in the passage I just read, you find Barnabas selling a property that he owned, and giving it for the good of the church. In the beginning of chapter 5, we find another man, Ananias, selling a property and saying that he gave all of that money to the church for the good of the church, but he had kept back a portion for himself. So one man was a great encouragement to the church, while the other man actually was a great discouragement to the church. The difference: one man used his resources to encourage others, while the other man actually discouraged the church by how he used his resources and how he said he was doing a big thing, but he kept a lot of it for himself. You see, how you use your resources to encourage others is a manifestation of your character. One man by the name of Joseph got the nickname of Great Encourager. The other man by the name of Ananias took his last breath on that day because he lied as to what he did. He presented himself as a bigger encouragement than he really was. The moral of the story is this: encouragement brings life to a church, while discouragement brings death. There's a second way that you can be an encouragement. You can be an encouragement by standing up for the outsider. Now, listen to more of the story of Barnabas. When Saul came to Jerusalem, he tried to join the disciples, but they were afraid of him, not believing that he really was a disciple. But Barnabas took him and brought him to the apostles. He told them how Saul on his journey had seen the Lord and that the Lord had spoken to him, and how in Damascus he had preached fearlessly in the name of Jesus. So Saul stayed with them and moved freely in Jerusalem, speaking boldly in the name of the Lord. You really can't blame the early church for being afraid of Saul. He had been rounding up Christians to be persecuted. Now he had become a believer, but no one really believed that he had a life change. That is, no one except Barnabas, and Barnabas stood up for him. It can be very encouraging to have someone stand up for you when others don't quite trust that God has been doing something good in your life. Let me remind you that you are going to have new people come to join you at Marsh Creek. Who will be the Barnabas among you? Remember, you don't know if the next person who comes to join you at Marsh Creek is going to end up being one of the most dedicated workers in the church. Over the years, I've found that the people who go out of their way for the new people come to be seen as the great encouragers. You can also be a great encourager by confirming God's work in others. Again, another glimpse into the life of Barnabas. Now, those who had been scattered by the persecution in connection with Stephen traveled as far as Phoenicia, Cyprus, and Antioch, telling the message only to the Jews. Some of them, however, men from Cyprus and Cyrene, went to Antioch and began to speak to Greeks also, telling them the good news about the Lord Jesus. The Lord's hand was with them, and a great number of people believed and turned to the Lord. News of this reached the ears of the church at Jerusalem, and they sent Barnabas to Antioch. When he arrived, he saw the evidence of the grace of God. He was glad and encouraged them all to remain true to the Lord with all their hearts. He was a good man, full of the Holy Spirit and faith, and a great number of people were brought to the Lord. There can be a lot of mistrust when the church is going through changes that people aren't too sure about. In this passage, God was doing some good things in the lives of people, and when the church needed to send someone to encourage them, they chose the encourager. When you see God doing something great in another person, it is very encouraging to acknowledge that work. It's helpful in a congregation when people are watching for and affirming one another when they see God at work. Encouragement is the atmosphere that encourages and sustains life transformation in a congregation. More encouragement, more life transformation. And fourth, you can be an encouragement by giving people a second chance. And again, from the life of Barnabas. Sometime later, Paul said to Barnabas, "Let us go back and visit the brothers in all the towns where we preach the word of the Lord and see how they are doing." Barnabas wanted to take John, also called Mark, with them, but Paul did not think it wise to take him because he had deserted them in Pamphylia and had not continued with them in the work. They had such a sharp disagreement that they parted company. Barnabas took Mark and sailed for Cyprus, but Paul chose Silas and left, commended by the brothers to the grace of the Lord. What do you do when people blow it? When people let you down, when they don't come through. It's easy to write people off and just move on to someone else. But people need second chances, and even more chances than that. An encourager takes chances on people. Yes, you will get burned from time to time. But then again, your second chance might just be what helps a person turn their life around. Now you might ask, why a message on encouragement? Why now? Marsh Creek is headed into another round of transition. A new pastor is arriving. New people will be entering your doors. If you've been here a while, you know how things go around here. But new people don't. You're going to need a high dose of grace and graciousness. We need people to step up and lean in. And one way that you can step up and lean in is by being a great encourager. So begin today. Who could use some encouragement? Where could you offer your support and encouragement to others? First, do you know anyone who would be encouraged by your financial support? Doesn't have to be a lot of money. Something that you give to someone as an encouragement? Second, do you know anyone who would be encouraged by you speaking up for them? Maybe it's in your family, maybe it's at work, maybe it's in your congregation. Do you know anyone who would be encouraged by your acknowledgement of God's work in their life? You see that God is doing something in their life and you take note of it. It's so encouraging to a person when somebody else sees what God is doing in me. And fourth, do you know anyone who would be encouraged by you giving them a second chance? When Dick Hoyt died in March, he left a life of legacy. He will be remembered for generations as a man of encouragement and support. Every generation that has been acquainted with the book of Acts remembers not Joseph, but Barnabas. Remembers him by his nickname because of his encouragement and support. How do you want to be remembered? I hope that you will build a legacy of being a person who is known for your encouragement. We need encouragers to step up and lean in. Let's pray. God, thank you for the encouragement that you give to each of us, that your Spirit comes alongside us and runs this race with us. Lord, would you help show us how we can be encouragers to others? Lord, give us eyes to see where just a little bit of encouragement might make a big difference. Help each of us, Lord, to build the legacy of being a people who encourage others because we are followers of Jesus Christ. Thank you, Lord, for your grace upon us so that we can be graceful to others. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen.
Doesn't stand a chance.
stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. Shame no longer has a place to hide, 'cause I am not a captive to lies. I'm not afraid to leave my past behind. Doesn't stand a chance when I